For all of us who believe in justice and fairness, we've got a huge job ahead of us, a huge job. Because the rules are ones that protected working people and encouraged our collective power are broken. They're well and truly broken. In the same way the very rich bend, push, break, or just ignore our tax laws, they bend, push, break, and ignore our workplace laws. Just look at wage theft, which is right across our workplaces, right across the country. It used to be that maybe your corner store didn't pay the minimum wage. Now it's a business model for employers, for multinationals. Everyone from celebrity chefs right through to multinational pizza chains engaging in, let's call it what it is, wage theft. 40% of the workforce is now in insecure work. Employers are able just to deem someone a casual, even if they work regular hours, even if they work regular hours for years. Or tell people they have to go and get their own ABN, pay their own workers' compensation, and still pay them less than the minimum wage. Because let's face it, these are all ways of getting around our rights at work, just like they do with our tax laws. Yesterday, the minimum wage decision was handed down. Our minimum wage is now only 42% of the average wage. It used to be 53%. We had an idea in this country, an idea we were the first people to have it, of the living wage. And that was one 100 years ago. And that was the idea that a working person working full time should earn enough to support themselves, another person, and two kids. We've lost that idea. We've lost that idea of a fair day's pay for a fair day's work. Our minimum wage after yesterday is $36,134 a year. You cannot afford to live in any of our capital cities, let alone most country towns, let alone support three other people on $36,000 a year. Penalty rates. That decision comes on the back of a five-year campaign by employers and the Turnbull government who relentlessly pursued the idea that our lowest paid workers should have a pay cut. And that is what the so-called independent umpire delivered, a pay cut to our lowest paid workers. Surely the rules are broken if we have situations where our lowest paid workers have their rates of pay cut. The rules that protected and supported us, the rules that made sure that those with the least power are protected are not any longer strong enough. And surely the answer to some people having too much power is working people having more power. Because what has happened? Too much wealth, too much power has gone to the top, to the 1% and to the multinational corporations around the world. And this is because we've followed blindly and relentlessly both major political parties, the ideology of trickle-down economics. We know what the results are now. The results are clear. The 1% in Australia earns more than 70% of the rest of us. 2 days ago, a profit announcement came out. From March to March, in 12 months, corporate profits have gone up by 39%. At the same time, wages have grown by less than 1%. These are the consequences of trickle-down economics. It has led to a situation where inequality is at a 76-year high. So, brothers and sisters, comrades, who is going to say enough is enough? Who is going to call out the broken laws, and who is going to organise to change them and to fight? Well, we will. The trade union movement of Australia will. We're getting ready to now. We're getting ready to, and we're getting ready to mobilise. Because we draw from our deep history, knowing that sticking together and being organised in unions is the way we create the rules, and and the way we change rules in our country, and they all underpin the living standards we've had that have made Australian society a fairer place than so many other places around the world. There's been plenty of times throughout our history where there's been broken rules and we've gone about changing them. When we won the 8-hour day, when we won equal pay for Indigenous people and for women, when we won the weekend in the first place, health and safety legislation, superannuation for all workers, parental leave, and even Medicare, all these were rules that we demanded to make society fair, and this is what we'll have to do again. Because it is by being organised in unions that we confront power at its sharpest point. It is at that point that we redistribute wealth. And they still need us. Employers still need us. By organising, we can change the balance of power. We can redistribute wealth, we can rewrite the rules. So we're building a movement to take on this fight, and there's strength in numbers, and we need you. We need every single one of you. Hands up if you're a member of your union. We need all of you. Those without your hands up, join us. We need you to be part of our movement too. And this is not about needing individual help in your workplace, although you will get that. This isn't about having someone by your side if you have a bullying boss, or if there's inequality in your workplace, but you'll get that too. This is about a simple idea that you put no price on and no one can take away from us. And that is the idea of solidarity. The simple idea of people sticking together and deciding to stick together. So I have these questions. If you want to fight inequality, join us. If you think all workers, no matter who they are, deserve the right to pay sick days or pay annual leave when they're sick or at the end of the year, join us. If you believe there should be limits on corporate greed, then join us. We are 1.8 million strong. We are the generation of unionists and of union leaders who are going to say, enough is enough. We've had enough. They've pushed us too far and we're ready to fight. And I've got a question for you, Progress 2017. Are you with me?
Yes!
Honey, are you with me?
Yes!
Are you with us?
Yes!
Thank you very much. So there's two often competing reasons for Trump's ascension. One is racism, the other is job insecurity. What's your view on that?
Well, it's interesting because we've done a lot of deep research into One Nation voters here in Australia, and it echoes the same debate that's happened in the US around why is it that people are supporting far-right racist answers. And it's because of this. People have an expectation gap between what they think life should be like as Americans or as Australians, what it actually has turned out to be. This exists especially in here, in Anglo-Saxon communities, where people see that their parents' life was better than theirs. And they were promised things like fair day's work for a fair day's pay. They thought they could get a good steady job. They thought that those opportunities would be there for them. And all of a sudden, they're being taken away. And so when that happens, people look for answers. Look for answers to fill that expectation gap. Why is it that Australia has not turned out how they thought it would? And at the moment, Pauline Hanson is filling that with answers. Just like Trump also filled that with answers. So whilst we have sections of society where there is racism, when people are insecure and when they're asking for questions, it creates a fertile ground for it. So
Insecurity is the base issue for so many people. Whilst people are insecure, they start questioning and they start looking for answers to why that's the case. It's our job as progressives to tell a different story, to tell the type of story I just very briefly did then. The reason why our jobs have been casualised, the reason why our jobs have been offshored, outsourced, the reason why inequality is growing is because of corporate greed. It's because some people have too much power and we don't have enough. And that's a very different story to what's being told by Glenn Hanson or Donald Trump.
So how specifically will the union movement in Australia turn around inequality?
First of all, we are going to spend the time telling the story of why we're in this situation, which is the one I just talked about. The point of that is to give people a framework, a different framework than what they're being given by the Turnbull government, who just relentlessly pursues trickle-down economics as the answer, or a different answer to what Pauline Hanson gives. So that's the first thing. And we're going to do that in workplaces, but right across our communities, not just in inner city Melbourne, but in country Queensland and everywhere. Then we're going to unite around the solutions. The reason why I talk about rules is because it makes it easy for people to see that it's not inevitable that society ends up like this. Rules are written by human beings, they can be rewritten or changed by human beings. So there's a clear answer and a hope for people, because the danger for all of us is that people start seeing these things as inevitable and therefore out of their control. So we've got to bring it back into people's control. And then make a story that only a strong movement, a strong people's movement, can bring about that change. When asking people to join the union, it's not instead of your other activism, it's part of your other activism. So everything else you're involved in, to obviously keep being involved in that, for us to build a united front of progressive people, people who are unemployed, people who are also retired and pensioners, people right across our community, the more we can unite everyone around that common goal of changing the rules to make Australia fairer, the better we'll be. So that's how we're going to go about fighting it.
It's a compelling and encouraging narrative. Thank you so much, Sally McManus.